A very heartily evening to all the guests present over here. I am Vishal Khatnani from G.H. Raisoni College of Commerce, Science and Technology. It's my pleasure welcoming you all in the fifth session of Orange City Literature Fest Edition 2 by SGR Knowledge Foundation. This session is of 40 minutes. We will be now discussing about the pearls and politics of history writing in India with Mr. Vikram Sampath sir. Bangalore-based historian Dr. Vikram Sampath sir is the author of four acclaimed books. His latest book is the first volume of a two-volume biography, Savarkar Echoes from a Forgotten Past from Penguin Random House, India, that has gone on to become a national bestseller and was acclaimed by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Vikram sir was awarded with the Sahitya Academy's first Yuva Puraskar in English Literature and the ARSC International Award for Excellence in Historical Research in New York for his book on Gauhar Jan. Vikram sir is also a trained Carnatic vocalist. He has established the Archive of India Music, India's first digital sound archive for vintage recordings, is the founder director of the Bangalore Literature Fest Indic Through Festival and the Z Group's ARTH A Culture Fest. This session will be moderated by Barkha Mathur ma'am. Barkha Mathur ma'am is a senior journalist working for the English dailies in the city for over two decades. She is also a columnist, blogger and author and has taught writing to the students of mass communication. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Vishal. And a very warm welcome, Vikram. It's such a pleasure to have you here and to be talking to you. I have seen that your work is enormous, you know, from a student, from an engineer to a mathematician to musician and writer. How does it happen? I mean, how do you pick up your subjects and how difficult is your research? Tell me this first, rather than readers, the viewers.
Thank you, Barkha. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. And thank you to the Orange City Literature Festival for inviting me over. A great pleasure always to speak to people in Nagpur, a city that I've had the great pleasure and honor of visiting several times in the past 1 year, especially after my book on Savarkar. That's a question that I often get confounded with, Barkha, about, the path taken so far. And I always wonder, I define my literary career as serendipity, a series of happy accidents, something that I really not planned ever to be a writer, historian at that. To be honest, history as a subject was something I hated in school, given the way it was taught, learning by rote, who succeeded whom, which war, and all these things which never made sense. And almost every history class meant kneeling outside because I wouldn't do my homework well. So my poor history teacher, I think she had quite a shock to know now that I'm called a historian. But, The changing point was in those days there was this serial on Doordarshan called The Sword of Tipu Sultan. I'm sure some of you would have seen that. There, in fact, it was by Sanjay Khan, and in that serial, the royal family of Mysore, the Wodeyars, they were shown in a very, very poor light to highlight, Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan, who were actually the usurpers to the throne of Mysore. The Maharaja and the Maharani of Mysore were shown in a very bad way. The Maharaja was shown like this obese retard who was dancing along with the court dancer. The Maharani was one of those typical vamps from an Ekta Kapoor serial who was all the time conniving and conspiring. And for that, there were lots of protests in different parts of Karnataka, about this. And as a 12 or 13 year old, who, as I said, did not like history too much, somehow this one episode was something that made a deep impact on me. And I decided that I really wanted to know the truth behind that falsehood. And never ever with the intention that this would become a book someday. And this madness, this junoon actually continued for almost 10 years. Every vacation meant going to Mysore, meeting members of the royal family, the palace archives, old historians there, collecting information. And it became like a family project. My parents, who dutifully supported me in all of that, my maternal grandmother, who used to help me translate things from Kannada to English and all of that. So it was like that. We put together a logbook kind of a thing of all these information that I was gathering. And the Wodeyars were among India's longest reigning royal houses, ruling for about 600 long years from 1399 to 1947. And as I started gathering more and more, I realized that there was not even a single book that was written on them in the modern times, which covered this entire time span of for a very important slice of Indian history. And that also kind of made me understand an important peril, which we could talk about later, about the historiography in India itself, the art of history writing, where large parts of India don't feature in the historical narrative of this country. Mm-hmm. Our history is largely Delhi-centric. We learn about every small little dynasty that ruled for insignificant time also in Delhi, but large parts of South India or northeast of India, all these parts of India don't feature at all in our country's story. And the Wadiyars were one such. And so that's how, many people told me then that, you've done so much work, why don't you put this together in the form of a book? And that's how my first book, Splendors of Royal Mysore, The Untold Story of the Wadiyars, it was untold because nobody bothered to tell it, came out in 2008, about 12 years ago. And as I said, serendipity again, one thing led to the other. While researching on Mysore, I came across the reference to this fascinating lady called Gauhar Jan, who was India's and the subcontinent's first artist and woman to record her voice on the gramophone in 1962. Yeah. She was a visiting musician at the Mysore court under the Maharaja's government, and she died in Mysore in 1930. And that's how I got so fascinated by her and went chasing her story. And that's the rest, as they say, is history.
Yeah, and what is more interesting is that your interest in music, in history, have all melted down to these wonderful books that you are producing. And this research, how difficult is research when you're writing as a historian? How difficult does that get?
That's historical research in India is a big problem because of. But it also depends on the topic. For instance, Gauhar Jan was literally like entering into a tunnel without knowing whether there's light at the end of it, because here was a tawai of a courtesan who died in 1930, and I came across her in 2006 or 7, and no legal heirs, no children, no students, no family. But it was just that the story was so fascinating, and I literally wanted to put this down, find out more about her without knowing how to do it. And that was like finding a needle in a haystack. I went through the length and breadth of India, one leading to the other with no clear path. You go to a place, it gives you some leads. As a journalist, more like an investigative journalism, where from Darbhanga, the place she was born, Azamgarh, to Banaras, Rampur, Darbhanga, Calcutta, where she lived for most of her life, Bombay, Madras, and also outside India to Berlin, London. I literally chased her through the length and breadth of India. It was like putting together pieces of a jigsaw puzzle of her life that it had turned out to be. So there it was very, very difficult, very complicated. But in a case like, say, a Savarkar, it's the opposite. It's a problem of plenty, where there is so much material. One visit I made to the British Library, I spent about a month in London in 2016-17, part of the research. So the British Library in London, the National Archives of UK, and believe you me, I've collected about 35,000 pages of material related to Savarkar. And so just from that one place, in Delhi, the archives in Delhi, the National Archives of Delhi, the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, where I'm a senior fellow there is 40,000-50,000 pages of material. There's something else somewhere in Bombay, in Pune, in so many other places. So there, and a lot of literature about him in Marathi. Mostly people, historians don't give value to Indian language literature. It's always, you're depending on colonial sources, you're depending on English. So taking those into account, so it's a mammoth amount of data and information. And I in fact wanted it to be a 3-volume book because there was just so much to fit in. But my publishers, Penguin Random House, they said, 2 is more than enough because we can't make a, it can't go on like that. And so that's how we had to zero it down. So the research is, there's no defined path. It is, and that's the whole, I think, intellectual rigor that keeps at least someone like me going, because you never really know what thing you stumble upon, and that will lead you to something else. And that whole joy of investigation, finding
and discovering for yourself also.
Correct. True. Meeting new people, especially in someone like Savarkar or my other protagonist, Veena S. Balachandar, the Carnatic musician my role. He died more recently, so they were still family members. There were people who were opposed to him, those who liked him. So interviewing all of them, meeting new people, understanding their life stories. I think a historian needs to do that, where put together a holistic picture together of documented sources, archival material, newspaper records, and also oral history, narratives, and so on through interviews and all of that. So it's a complex process. It takes a lot of time. So each book of mine, I think, takes a minimum, if not more, of 3 to 4 years before it can come out. So it does require that perseverance. And
you tread the dangerous path also. Being a historian, you have to be doubly sure that everything is correct, etc. And I think it has encouraged you to set up an archive of sorts also, because you are researching so much. So you have set up some kind of an archive also, I understand.
True. This is, it's not of a document, but it's of music. So that's kind of Indian music. So while researching on Gauhar Jaan, I realized that, as I said, she was the first artist to record and on the 78 RPM gramophone shellac discs. But today, if we want to actually listen to those 78 RPMs, there are no machines, there are no discs to the needle that goes on that.
True.
That's not available. During my visit to Europe, in a fellowship in Berlin, I actually managed to go across Europe to Vienna, to Paris, to London, to Berlin, all of whom had the concept of a national sound archive, where the musical heritage, not only music, it's also voices of people, voices of common people, voices, a large, holding of Indian voices, Indian prisoners of war who were in the German camps. In the First World War, their voices, about 100 of them, preserved in an archive in Berlin called the Laut Archive. And it gave me goose flesh to listen to, our ancestors speaking in Punjabi, Sindhi, Tamil, Pashto, all these different
languages. Fascinating this is, absolutely.
Yeah, and all of them kept asking me that, does India have a national sound archive? And, as a Indian, as a student of music, as a student of history, it made me very, very sad and embarrassed that we do not have one such institution. So on coming back, in fact, I had spoken extensively with the previous government of India, this was 2010, that please set up something like this and I will give all my support to do this. But how governments are, nothing moved anywhere, and it didn't take off. But I was lucky to get the support of Mr. T.V. Mohandas Pai, who was then with Infosys. And he said, why do you want to go behind government? You set it up as a private trust and I'll give the seed money. So we imported all the machines to digitize these things and collected these gramophone records from chor bazaars, raddi shops, people who had thrown it away from these places. And we've collected about 15,000 gramophone discs covering Indian classical music, folk music, early theater recordings, early cinema, speeches of leaders, all this digitized, and it's freely available on SoundCloud. So those who are tuning in, on soundcloud.com, if you go and press Archive of Indian Music, about 3,000 plus tracks are already there, free of cost. It's the the property of each and every Indian man and woman, and so I think it should be freely accessible to everybody. That was the idea.
Beautiful work, I must say, absolutely. Now that we know about you and how you've been going about, would you agree if I say that we Indians don't put any value on our history at all? Museums, are decrepit dungeons where people have stopped going altogether. They are badly kept. They are absolutely in shambles. Would you agree with me when I say this? We have no respect for our history.
Totally. I think that a truer word could not have been said. That I think the very fact that we have too long and stormy and illustrious a history, maybe that is the exhaustion that we have. And of course, a lot of politics that comes in play, about which I'm sure we'll talk about, which ensures that even, commoners, we don't have that regard for our past. But this is the irony that, troubles me. That for a nation like this, who does not have that regard for the past or for documentation or preservation, we get so touchy about characters of the past and how they are portrayed. So in my own hometown in Bangalore, Tipu Sultan is like, you know, an icon that who's been appropriated by contemporary politicians all the time. And there's politics that goes on whether his birth anniversary needs to be celebrated or not, and there's a Congress BJP fight going on that all the time. But then, and people get it's so terrible that, you know, there is a section 144 imposed, there is police firing, people die for this, people are killed, there's riots and all of that. But then Tipu's summer palace in Bangalore is in shambles. The armory is where he manufactured the first ever rockets and missiles in Srirangapatna. They are not at all intended. So we get so touchy about the person. Same in your state, I think Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj being what he is. But how much of effort goes in preserving Shivaji Maharaj's forts and make it, create that experience for, say, a visitor who comes to Maharashtra, saying, go on a life journey of Shivaji Maharaj through these forts, that itself could become such a wonderful way of immersion in the past. Something like what happens in the UK, where the English Heritage Trust that is there. History is not a dead subject for people there. It's something that is experiential. You go through, you immerse in it. There are audio guides. You live that era again. I remember in Vienna going to Mozart's house, the composer, and we were given these audio guides, and every room, the different symphony of Mozart was playing, and it was almost like he was sitting right there talking to us, playing his favorite songs. So history can be made exciting, interesting, and inspiring, particularly for the young people. And also it can become a very important source of a country's soft power, of its, a source of employment, skill generation.
Tourism high spots. They can be tourism high spots, these places of historical,
Exactly. So we don't do all of that, but then one sentence someone says about Shivaji Maharaj and the whole of Maharashtra will be, in flames. So that is the whole sadness, the irony of the whole problem, which is a problem for a historian too, who would be writing about something like.
No, we don't even encourage our children to go visit the museums. That is the problem, That is another issue.
What can they go there and learn? Because it's really nothing that you come out enriched in any way compared to, say, a Victoria Albert Museum in London, where you can spend, or a Louvre in Paris, where you can spend, a week easily trying to get into each exhibit. Yes. Is there any dearth of, rich historical content, artistic content in our country? But we don't know how to showcase our own strengths. We don't know how to, play up our own intangible soft power. And that is the sad state.
We get snatches of our history at these museums across Europe and America. So now, your first volume of Savarkar is out and you are in the process of doing the second volume. You're doing history. Now, it's tricky, documenting history in India, as we have been talking about it. So how prepared are you? You are doing Savarkar's second volume. You will be doing Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj's life story. So how prepared are you? What precautions do you take? How sensitive do you get to these issues which will really touch the nerves, of the people? So how do you prepare yourself for this and your book also for this?
On a lighter note, just activate all your friends abroad saying if I need asylum anywhere, there are riots in my name.
And so your publishers, brave publishers you have, I must say.
So, in fact, this had happened, in the first book on Mysore. So there was just one small section on Tipu Sultan and Hyder Ali. And I was giving a talk only on that in a place in Bangalore. And he's, again, as I said, a very polarizing figure. So suddenly, in the middle of the talk, there were lots of protests. There were people who were throwing some paper rockets and all of that. And the talk had to be abruptly shut down. It came in all the newspapers the next morning. And some of those Tipu fan club or whatever they were, they just came and told my father, who was in the audience, that, you have only one son, so you better, if you're worried about his life, you better, take appropriate measures. So it was a veiled, not so veiled threat as well. And my effigy was burnt right in the center of the city in MG Road because of an article I wrote on him. So these, and in fact, I remember my mother had then said, you are not going to talk promise me you're not going to talk about Tipu Sultan anywhere outside. And today I'm writing up his biography. So I really don't know what is going to lead one to. But that's what I said. It's difficult to for a historian, if one keeps thinking that, okay, what's going to happen? Are they going to be? Because every subject is a landmine, particularly political subjects like these. Maybe you can just write about harmless, some artists, etc., which will not create much controversy. Then maybe that's the only history we are able to digest. But I think someone needs to bell the cat. And so these subjects I'm writing on, as you said, Savarkar, Shivaji, and Tipu Sultan, all of whom,
most contentious.
Yeah, by all the political wings, right wing, left wing, all these different wings. So, but then I think the honesty of the historian is what is important there, where the idea is not just to create controversy for the sake of it, which many people do, to be honest, because nothing sells better than controversy. And so, but then if it is backed by solid research and solid documentation, to be honest, I was quite apprehensive about my work on Savarkar too, as to how it would be received, considering, after so many decades after his death, in 1966, he still, intrudes contemporary political discourse.
Yes.
He's so polarizing, in terms of those who are for him and those who are against him. So will I be caught in this crossfire was a question that me and my family constantly asked. But I think the power of the research that was put, the documentation for every little claim, I think I have I have a backing for that. There are 120 pages of only end notes and bibliography and all of that. So then it becomes difficult for anybody, unless someone is determined to cause you physical harm or malicious intent, then I think you're by and large covered. So, but one needs to be very circumspect about what one writes, how one places these very sensitive topics, because as you rightly said, it touches a very raw nerve, because these characters are like that.
So since we are at it, polarization and all this, we are talking. So history most of the time is also at the mercy of the ruling establishment. So, and these, they have power to fudge it, to some extent rewrite it. We are constantly today hearing it, that our history books are all wrong. There will be a new government and there will be change in the history syllabus. Why is it, why do we need to do it? See, history actually should be honest. And it obviously is honest, because you are writing what has already happened. Then what happens? Why do historical books come under so much of political fire, or under fire, if I may say?
That's a million-dollar question. So
I'm sure you are addressing it all the time.
Yeah, true. So it was I'm reminded of what George Orwell said, that he who controls the past controls the present, I think controls the future also. And so history always becomes a very important component of the culture wars, where even if you may not have regard for it, appropriation of it, the way it is narrated, that becomes paramount, especially in the field of politics. Now, the nature of the subject is, what you said is right, that what happened in the past, but it's not just that documentation. The problem comes in the interpretation. The nature of the subject is, it's so malleable that there is nothing called absolute history. I always liken history to that famous English poem, right, of the blind man and the elephant. So each blind man is asked to touch different parts of the elephant and say, what do you think the elephant is? So someone says it looks like the tail, someone says it looks like the trunk, someone says something else, the body of the elephant. All of them are right and all of them are wrong, because it's a sum of parts. So history is something like that. Depending on the amount of documentation available to you at that particular moment, what appears to you as true is true, but it need not be the absolute truth. That nature of history, which makes it subjective, also necessitates that the subject is based on differing viewpoints, dissent, discussion, debate, and in fact, thereby becoming a bedrock of democracy. What else is democracy where there are no parallel, opposing viewpoints coming together? Now, the sad part in India has been that, particularly after independence, I would say, there's been an effort to monochromatize history and history writing to an extent which is captured by ideology. And I name it the leftist Marxist ideological hold on history and history writing, where no alternative viewpoint is ever entertained, you know, through institutions like the ICHR, the Indian Council for Historical Research, and so on. Yeah, so they've been gatekeepers of what true history of India constitutes. Where is the alternative voice that is never allowed to thrive? People have lost their careers, their livelihoods, only because
their credibility.
Indeed. You know, because they held a different viewpoint. So in such a scenario, there's just one narrative that exists, and thereby there is no counter that can ever come to. So in fact, even the way, you know, Indian history is shown, we've all read in our history textbook, we see India and Indian history as a litany of, you know, wars that we have lost.
Invasions,
wars, yeah. Right from the battle that the invasion by Ghazni till the East India Company and all those Anglo.
The chronology of wars.
Chronology of, and we are a nation of losers. So that's what is drilled into our heads. And this was a colonial construct. The British historians wanted us to believe that right from the, you know, mythical Aryan invasion theory that was propounded. So you guys don't even deserve to be ruled by yourself. There's always an external agency who will come in, they will invade, they will conquer you culturally, intellectually, socially. You will be made civilized. And that's why we have also come as the, you know, it's a white man's burden to civilize the blacks. So that was what was told to us by our colonial masters. And after independence, instead of correcting this narrative, we have very blindly taken that and made it worse, thanks to the Marxist historians. So if we as a civilization today are still around, our traditions are around, our languages are around, our religions are around, our rituals are around, all of it is still around, there must have been some wars we fought, we won also, and there must have been some resistance we put to invaders, to everybody who tried to rampage us. So where are those stories? Where do those, stories, and I'm not talking about this with some chauvinism and revivalism that, oh, Mera Bharat Mahan type of thing. But then for 1,000-odd years, if we have been invaded, but still, as that famous share goes, kuch to baat hai ki hamari, hamara...
Kuch baat hai ki hasti mitti nahi hamari.
Mitti nahi hamari.
Satyo raha re dushman sara raha hamara.
Bilkul, so what is that kuch baat? What is it that, can't we make it tangible? Can't our history books talk about what this tangible thing is? And this whole looking at ourselves, and this is a Nehruvian construct, trust me, and about looking at our past, looking at our traditions, our religion, with a sense of shame, with a sense of embarrassment, that, you know, if we look back at our past, other than the caste oppression, etc., there's nothing else that we have to be proud of. What about our achievements in different fields, in the fields of astronomy, in the fields of, you know, sciences, in chemistry, alchemy, mathematics, medicine, you know, architecture, our entire philosophy, our approach to life, the way our faiths, you know, don't talk about one book and one truth and one God and all of that, that whole sense of there's one truth but many parts to it, this kind of embraceiveness, where all these aspects of our own past, of which we can be genuinely proud of, not again with the sense of jingoism, why don't these aspects of our past never form part of our historical narrative in textbooks, in popular books, and so on? So these problems that exist, I think, make the way history is written, perceived, so difficult, and it also makes it so malleable. And that's been the case all the time, Barkha, because, I mean, history is the handmaiden of the ruler.
Yeah, it's a tool. Time, political tool.
In the old times, you had the kings who would, write, have their court historians writing their biographies and all that, extolling and praising them. So
true.
Now we have the royal historians of the establishment, whichever party flavor, etc. Of course, the current government, everybody, at least those who are sympathetic to them, would actually deride them, that they are not doing enough at all to correct this history. And this correction of history, I think it should go beyond ideological tint of JP and Congress and so on, but based on those aspects that I just listed, the BJP, Congress can come and go, we wouldn't care any less. But I think the story of India, the story of our civilization, of our ancestors, our achievements, our journey through civilization, I think that is much more important than any political party or ideology. that needs to come out in a way that our future generations will be proud of being Indian and not be so ashamed of being a land of losers whose contribution to this world was just the invention of zero and nothing else. True. So we really need that corrective very, very soon.
So, see, Vikram, you've been writing about history, and there are many interpretations of a single historical event. Hana, so how, as a historian, how does one manage to convince the people or whoever is consuming those things to that his perspective is accurate or is well researched? I mean, it requires convincing. You would agree.
I don't convince them at all. That's the best part. So, for instance, in time and time again, even in the Savarkar book, which I think actually needed convincing, I would tell people that, look, I don't want to be an advocate for Savarkar. I mean, he's dead and gone. He doesn't need me as a lawyer. My job as a historian is not to sit there in judgment of characters of the past based on yardsticks of today. So today, if I also, you know, write about Tipu Sultan and call him secular, communal, all these definitions are of today's India. You can't put that definition to an 18th century ruler of South India and say he was also secular. I mean, those terms itself did not exist. Historians, role, according to me, is one not to sit in judgment, not to convince anybody, because that would undermine the reader's intelligence. I think the historian's work is to illuminate the archives, illuminate the documents, illuminate all the oral histories, which a common man or woman does not have the time or interest to go, invest 4 years in getting all this information. Bring all that information into the public realm. Let your readers decide for themselves. So in the case of Savarkar, all these contentious things, his so-called mercy petitions, you have the was he a British stooge, was he a traitor, all these kind of things that keep coming up. So all the facts put together, put out there, those who were for him, in fact, in the appendix to the book, all his petitions I have put in toto as I got them from the British Library. So let a reader who can read English, such a fat book, can also read these documents, and she can make up her own mind. Why do I have to school her saying this is the truth and this is accurate? Because as I said, there is nothing accurate about history. So tomorrow, if you are able to come across some evidence which completely overthrows my 4 years of hard work and undermines it, my book can be thrown into the dustbin and your book will become the most authoritative book on Savarkar. So that is the beauty of the subject, where there is no final word. Some famous historian had said, every work of history is an interim report. So it is just that, it is an interim report, and historians need to have that humility that they're not sitting here as judges in a prosecution case saying, okay, I pass Savarkar as guilty, okay, I exonerate Tipu Sultan as being... It's not our role. I mean, someone else, a new judge will come who will pass a new judgment. So just bring the facts out, let the readers decide.
But if I take it from the reader's point of view also, see, we have this tendency, we believe everything that is written in our religious scriptures, mythology, whatever, it is there is the gospel for us. But we will keep on doubting the history, ancient, medieval, we don't want to believe in anything. What is this kind of a thing, I mean, that we don't trust our history, but we will believe in whatever the sages have written or which has come down to us as religion. We believe in religion, we don't believe in history. Do you agree with that? Give it a religious connotation and we are good with it. But tell us that it's a historical fact and we don't want to agree. We want to debate, we want to argue, we will have our own ideologies coming in. Do you think that is the way it happens?
I would probably not agree entirely, but I would say even in religion, the good part at least of the Indian faiths is that we do not believe in, as I said, one road to heaven. We do believe in multiple interpretations. So this is a country where even a Charvak who was an atheist, you can be an atheist, you can be a Nirishwarvad, Vadi, and still be a Hindu, so to say. So we've had that openness to religion. There's a thing called a blasphemy, where in our religious, in our Puranas, we have gods being cursed by common people. Just yesterday or something was this whole Tulsi and Krishna's wedding and so on. And the story behind that, Tulsi, she was some sage's wife who was actually raped by Lord Vishnu or molested by Vishnu, and she curses Vishnu. And so there's this whole story. God for us is not this person sitting in a uncha akash and giving verdicts and sending us to hell or heaven and all of that. He or she, we are the only country which also looks at God as a woman, Adi Shakti. So we have these multiple interpretations even of religion, and we can, there is a Ninda Stuti, there is a Ninda Bhav, where our bhakti poets have, shided and derided the God. There is nothing called blasphemy. That your head will be cut off if you say anything bad against God and his messenger and all those things. Yeah.
No, it's only in the Hindu religion,
Correct.
It would be blasphemy.
True. So we've had that openness, but your question on, this is also a very important issue, which again, we have not addressed post-independence and which has been held against us all the time. In fact, when Al-Biruni came to India, he wrote in his Tehqeeq-e-Hind, that the Hindus, they don't have any sense of history. They don't know how to document. Their thing is all mumbo-jumbo stories, this and that. So I think the basic difference in the Western approach to history writing and our approach to history writing, theirs is a linear structure. Ours is a cyclical structure.
Yes.
So our Puranas and so all of that we have, couched in a lot of myth, couched in a lot of story, is the actual kernel of truth. It is not made easily available to people. So there needs to be someone, everything about our things, I mean, the Pythagoras theorem, they say it's embedded in the Sulba Sutras, right? And but if you go to a Sulba Sutra and expect that he will write A square equal to B square plus C square, it will not be so easily written. It will be written in a poetic form, in that you will have to, search for it somewhere. And in the middle, you will find it embedded, and then you'll have a eureka moment saying, hey, I found this particular thing. So that is how our philosophy, our writing, our ancestors have always approached knowledge. And that difference in approach between a Western way of documentation and an Indian way of documentation, that needs to be noted. And this particular aspect has never been, propagated or made popular, particularly after independence, when we should have seen India has had a unique way of approach. It's unique approach to every aspect of life, including in the way we document our past. So what is that unique Indian approach to documenting our past? That has not been explored. We have continued the same models which we have imported from the West. And that's why it doesn't work most often in the Indian context.
The good news is that history, reading of historical literature is now winning, it's gaining ground. People are getting interested, that reading it with some kind of a perception. So how important would you say is reading history for everyone, in a nation? As a nation, how much value should we be putting to our history and the literature that is coming out from it?
As that same, grown-up version of the young boy who hated history in school, who didn't know the importance of the subject then. As I, research and write about it now, it becomes...
And how you have evolved.
true. Yeah. That, a subject like this, as I said, he who controls the past controls the future. I think history has this horrible tendency of repeating itself. The cliche that it says history repeats itself. Mm. For those who don't care to listen the very first time. I was finding that while I was researching and writing my volume 2 of Veer Savarkar now, in Nagpur people would know, Maharashtra people would know that immediately after Mahatma Gandhi's assassination, there was a huge genocide, to say, of the Maharashtrian Brahmins in different parts of Maharashtra, in Nagpur too, where different, Brahmin households were, attacked, their lives were taken, their properties destroyed, only because Nathuram Godse was a Brahmin. And this particular episode in our past was completely whitewashed. There were no police records, there were no FIRs filed most often. The victims went, without any justice. And most of them left the villages and the other towns, Nagpur, Satara, Ahmednagar, all of that, and migrated to Mumbai, Pune, the bigger cities where they could get lost in the larger population their caste identity did not matter so much. That's why many of the villages in Maharashtra would not even have too many Brahmin families today. Most of their lands have been taken over. Now, this happened in 1948. Now, we did not bother to take cognizance of this, that what can happen when an important political figure gets killed, their party's workers can go on a rampage and cause harm to common people who have no connection with that crime. We didn't take cognizance of that, and we saw a repeat of that in
1984
Indira Gandhi's murder and the anti-Sikh carnage in Delhi. So history will keep repeating itself. It will keep showing you the problems and the pitfalls that you will have. But if you wake up, take notice, take corrective action, that is what I think the past does. We cannot change the past, we cannot correct it. What has happened, the horrors, the problems, we cannot undo that. I think what history needs to do, and it does worldwide, is provide this safe space for people across the world to vent the horrors of their own past and provide this healing space. We are not saying such a thing never happened, and that's another problem with Indian history writing, where whether it's the invasions, where all these Hindu Muslim issues crop up, maybe whitewash these different atrocities, and we say these things never happened. Oh, but Aurangzeb was an extremely tolerant ruler. So that is, I think, a double crime to the victims, where you first deny first of all, you don't acknowledge their hurt, the crime, the loss they suffered. Second, you deny that such a thing even happened, like what happened with the Maharashtrian Brahmins in Maharashtra. So,
or you pick up facts to suit yourself, suit your narrative.
True. So I think what history needs to do is like what happened in South Africa, a Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Where if the victim and the perpetrator are together, they come eye to eye metaphorically. The victim then says, I forgive you, Ubuntu. The thing is healed, and then you move on. In India, the problem is people, the politicians, the history historiographers have always thought that we need to build an edifice of national unity on the false foundation, by whitewashing all these crimes. Oh, but if we talk about those, it will harm social unity today. Now, why should any young person of any community today feel offended if one says Ghori or Ghazni or Aurangzeb or Tipu Sultan was a tyrant? It's not some responsibility that anybody here carries today. So these were crimes perpetrated against this nation, against all our ancestors. So acknowledge it, heal it, and move on. I think that role of history as a healing tool, again, is something we have not done. And that is why, whether it was a Ram Janmabhoomi issue, whether all these things, where you don't address the issue head on, you slide it under the carpet, thinking that, on that you...
It will go away, wish it away.
Yeah, wish it away. You put a deodorant, but all the muck that you put under the carpet, at some point, it will stink, it will raise a slench, and that cancer will fester and manifest itself as social upheavals, as communal troubles, time and time again. So looking the issue in the eye, sorting it out once and for all, healing and moving on, I think that is an important role that history plays for a society, for a civilization, which in India in the last 73 years, we have unfortunately not done.
Lovely. Thank you so much, Vikram. This was a beautiful, very enlightening, very informative chat. Thank you. I'm sure the viewers enjoyed. Vishal, all yours.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all. On behalf of Orange City Literature Fest by SGR Knowledge Foundation, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. And I also would like to acknowledge our radio partner, Big FM. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everybody. Thank you,
ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
20 years of existence. 2 universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Thai Sony Group of Institutions, a vision beyond.